You like
hello, everybody. Let me quickly introduce our speaker. I'm very excited to welcome Adam Mastroianni. He's a social psychologist. He studies how people perceive and misperceive the world around them. And he runs a really successful blog about psychology, which is called Experimental History, and some of us really love reading it. In his blog, he made several very controversial statements, which include the idea that scientists can write as normal people, or the idea that we might want to spend more time just doing our own research and focusing on our creative ideas as compared to judging what everybody else has done. Adam is also a professional, talented comedian. He has played a supporting role in a movie that has a 3% rating on Rotten Tomatoes.
Thank you.
Isn't?
It's called Love, Weddings, and Other Disasters, not to be confused with Love and Other Disasters, which is a good movie. This one's a bad. This, if you imagine, like, what's that movie with all the different storylines? It's in the UK at Christmas. Love Actually. Imagine Love Actually, but it's set in Boston in the fall, and it's not good. And I am there. If you stream it after this, I probably get like 3 cents. So please do, and keep hitting refresh. Thanks, Marina, for having me. Thanks, everybody, for being here. It's really exciting to be here. And I have a confession to make, which is I have no idea what I'm doing. And I never have. Ever since I became an experimental psychologist, I've kind of just been screwing around. I sort of expected that when you show up to graduate school that someone tells you like what it is we do here, but nobody ever did. Like I took like a methods class, and I took a statistics class, but those are all about like the things you do once you know what you're doing and how to get to the end. There was no one who ever told me like of the infinite space of things that I could do, like why should I do this one versus that one? And so I sat in my advisor's office for hours and we talked about ideas. And we ended up doing the ones that seemed cool, which was fun, and I still like doing that, but I was haunted the whole time by this thought, which is like, how do we know this all amounts to anything? Like we're having a good time, and like we put out the papers, but what does that do other than make the stack of papers taller? Like how do we know we're making progress in psychology? I've got this image in my head that like we're all on a bus that is supposedly heading to Cincinnati, but there's no road signs, there's no GPS, and so how do we even know that we're going in the right direction? I'd really like to know the answer to this question because like I want to help us get there. I think psychology is, I would say, maybe the most important in science. It's certainly the one I like the best. But the better we understand our minds, the better we can use them, the better lives we can live. And so I would really like to contribute to the project of getting us closer to Cincinnati. But I'm not sure if we are drawing closer or not. How could we know? Today, I'll argue there are 5 ways that we could know. And in one of those ways, psychology is doing really, really well. And in the other 4, not so much. I will start by laying out that one way and those 4 ways. Then I will suggest as to why maybe we haven't been making so much progress. And at the end, I'll suggest like how we could. I don't know what your local norms are in terms of asking questions. You raise hands, do you speak up? Do you wait until the end? Okay, you punch the speaker. Well, I'll see you coming because we have like a demilitarized zone around the podium, so that's good. Okay, I'm cool with whatever. I'm used to giving talks in business schools where the norm is you just start talking, and also the norm is you just make up the data. So I'm familiar with a lot of different ways of doing things. You can see why I'm not there anymore. So I'm gonna say some critical things about the field. So I'd really like to start on a high note, which is what I think psychology does really well. Any scientific field can make progress by overturning our intuitions. Like long before we had a thing that we called science, humans still had to figure out how to navigate the world. So they still had to build up models about how things work. Psychologists call these models things like folk biology and folk physics and folk economics. There is obviously also folk psychology, and it's a very long book. And we are really good at testing those intuitions and overturning them. In fact, I would go out on a limb and say, whatever you consider progress in psychology is very likely to come in this kind of domain. If you think about the stuff that we now think of as like classic work in our field, like Milgram or like the heuristics and biases tradition, This stuff is all solidly in the tradition of overturning folk psychology. I once got into an amicable disagreement with the moral and developmental psychologist Paul Bloom about the nature of progress in psychology. And he was like, look at all of these amazing things we have done in the past few decades. And he sent me a list. And that list was really helpful because it was looking at that list that I realized that it all had this in common. I'll show you his top five. Babies have a surprisingly sophisticated understanding of the physical and social world. Our conscious experience of the world is sharply limited. Memory is not an accurate recording. Perception is a complex inferential process, and psychological traits are heritable. Every single one of these is a discovery because it's a falsification of a hypothesis that comes from our folk psychology. And I think all this stuff is great. Like, this is why I became a psychologist in the first place, because this is cool. And I think there's plenty more to be done here. However, in my opinion, it doesn't seem like the progress that we've made in this domain has bled into progress in other domains. For instance, if we're good at overturning our intuitions, it would make sense that we'd be good at outperforming intuition. Like, for instance, if you built a bridge using folk physics, it shouldn't stay up as well as a bridge built using actual physics. And we don't run a lot of like John Henry style showdowns like that, but when we do, the outcomes are not overwhelmingly in our favor. I can show you just a few of them. Just this year, a big project came out called the Strengthening Democracy Challenge. The challenge was to strengthen democracy by making Democrats and Republicans like each other more. This is a huge thing in my field right now. If you look closely at the results, you will find that one of the best performing interventions is watching a Heineken commercial from 2017. I was just chatting about, this is actually a pretty good commercial. It made me want to drink Heineken. But this was developed not by psychologists for the purposes of making partisans like each other more. It was developed by marketers for the purposes of selling beer. And yet, it was just as good as the interventions designed by the experts for the purposes of doing the thing that the challenge was about. That's more from like my side of social psychology. Over in clinical and counseling psychology, there's debate going on about whether random nice people might be just as good as trained psychotherapists. We like can't run this study anymore. There was a really bad study back in the 70s that couldn't find any difference between them. And now it's out of bounds. You're not allowed to just randomly assign someone to go talk to a history professor instead of a licensed psychotherapist. But what we can tell now is it is a little bit hard to find the difference between a trainee psychotherapist and one that has completed their licensure or one that's been working for a while, which casts some doubt as to whether we are giving people during their training like useful information that makes them better at treating mental illnesses. In personality psychology, you might be familiar with the Big Five model. This is like the Honda Civic of personality psychology. This is like the result of many years of engineering. Everyone agrees it's a solid car. And if you're not familiar with it, it's basically the idea that all human personality traits boil down to five factors: openness to experience, conscientiousness, extroversion, agreeableness, and neuroticism, which has recently been rebranded as emotional stability. So it's nice to have that one too. And just this year, a group called Clearer Thinking ran a study where they asked, how good is the Big Five at predicting life outcomes compared to some other popular personality tests? Now, keep in mind, the Big Five, one reason that we've kept it around so long is because it is good at doing that. Like, that's one reason why it's so popular. Unfortunately, the Enneagram can predict life outcomes just as well as the Big Five can. If you're not familiar with the Enneagram, it is a personality assessment that comes out of a spiritualist tradition. A rude way of explaining how the Enneagram was developed was someone pulled it out of their ass. Whereas the Big Five, like whatever it is that we do, we've done a lot of it to that. Like many studies, multiple decades, probably millions of dollars of research money spent. But at the end of the day, it doesn't actually perform better than something that people just made up. Yes.
I mean, he did have an excellent mustache, to be fair. Like the Enneagram. Mm-hmm. The other thing is all of these numbers are quite low.
Yes. Yeah, sorry. They're hard to see because there's a lot of them. They're not super high. And like some of this you can move around by which outcomes are you trying to predict. But yeah, it's not like this thing that we've worked on forever is really good at being able to tell whether someone will buy a house or get married or commit a crime, which are things that a personality test conceivably should be able to do. You notice the Jungian type that's on this chart is the Myers-Briggs. The reason they have to call it Jungian type is because Myers-Briggs is actually a protected trademark, and you can't get access to it without like taking a class and paying thousands of dollars. So they were trying to do their best. The Jungian type doesn't perform as well as either of these. But and the thing that's not even on this chart, they also used sun signs. So just like when you were born, your astrological sun sign. It is somewhat of a relief to know that that's at zero. So like these are doing something more than just astrology, but the thing that has the extra active ingredient of science in it isn't doing something much beyond the other things.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So like, well, first of all, I feel like marketers are actually very sophisticated people who know that people of different races drinking beer together is a powerful image. And talking to nice people is really helpful. So it's interesting to me that the top two, maybe I'm too cynical about psychology, but I would never really have expected academic psychology to outperform in these areas, maybe for very specific therapy for specific problems that random nice people can't really handle. And the last thing, I mean, if you think that your life outcome has a lot to do with chance and your circumstances and society, then I'm not sure what my ambitions are for how accurate I expect to predict things from personality. So I'm not sure that any of these strike me as terrible blows against science.
Yeah, I think I have a higher standard for what I hope we would be able to achieve by studying the structure of the mind. I mean, similarly, like a human just by walking around the world has knows a lot about physical relationships between things, and so like knows enough about physics to know like how to not fall off a cliff or like not die by things crushing you. What they can't do is go to the moon, and they'll never be able to go to the moon just by like bumping around the world and developing their folk physics.
But none of these are like going to the moon. I mean, maybe therapy for someone with really serious problems is like going to the moon.
Yeah, I think curing depression would be like going to the moon.
It would be eventually, so if you take the right one, if you take specific issues like anxiety disorders, then it's better. And also if you take intelligence tests, those tests are also much better.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's not zero. However, it's also... if we're debating whether the confidence interval includes zero, then we've a little bit given up the game. Right, so we don't get that many of these, right, of like comparing what we get from doing our science thing to what we would get from not doing that thing. And so instead we could just look at like, what can we accomplish using the knowledge that we've gained? I think this is also a realm in which we struggle, that we have a hard time using our knowledge to do stuff. For instance, our treatments for youth mental illness and adult depression over time have not improved over the past 50 years, as far as we've been able to tell. I single these out because these are the ones where we have the longest data and where we've have done the meta-analyses, not because these work and others don't. We don't know whether we've improved at the other ones on this timescale. Similarly, like we supposedly know a lot about behavior change, or at least like there's been a lot of papers about behavior change. There's many theories about behavior change. But when it comes time to actually change behavior, we struggle. Like our state of the art for behavior change is still try everything and see what works. Like literally, this is a sort of terrifying graph from a recent study, what's now called a mega study. This is like a hot thing right now. And what a mega study is you literally try everything that sounds reasonable and then see what works. So this mega study was about trying to get people to go to the gym more often, which by the way is not like, this isn't going to the moon. This is just trying to get people to do something that they already agree they would like to do. And these are people with gym memberships. So they're people who have established they'd like to go to the gym and they already go to the gym some amount, at least enough to go there and get a membership. They tried 53 different interventions. Half of them did not work at all. they simultaneously had people try to predict, experts, behavioral science experts and public health experts, had them try to predict which ones would work and which ones wouldn't. The predictions are all these tiny little orange bars, and the actual is the blue ones. And they, as you can see, they dramatically overestimated how effective all of these interventions would be, and they weren't able to tell which ones would be more effective than the other ones. In fact, in a different mega study, this one was about trying to get people to take vaccines, a sample of non-experts was actually better at predicting which interventions worked than the experts were, which I think is somewhat humility-inducing, that like even though we've got this big stack of papers about how to change people's behavior, when we try to do it, we aren't able to turn that stack into large effect sizes that we can predict beforehand. Where we especially struggle is turning any of our knowledge into technology, which is another way to assess the progress of a field. Like, the cool thing about an internal combustion engine is that you don't need to know how internal combustion works to use one. We know enough about the mechanics here that we can embed the knowledge in the technology itself, put it in a box, hand it to someone else who can use it without knowing any of the knowledge that's inside the box. I can't really think of anything in psychology that's like this. There's some things I think that are arguably based on this, like there's memory apps that are based on some findings from memory literature, or like retirement savings apps. Maybe you have one, yes?
Some people claim that lots of current developments in AI originated in early studies in psychology.
Yes. Yeah, this I think is a fair one, that like when we talk about reinforcement learning, the first people to talk about reinforcement learning were psychologists, which I think is like a point on the board in our favor. I wish that wasn't a 100-year-old idea, but it's still cool that we discovered it. I also think that the intellectual lineage of that idea is slightly less clear, that like it very quickly leaves psychology and becomes something that the computer scientists are doing. But I think it's fair that like we contributed to that project, and I think that's good for us. Otherwise, I have a hard time thinking of more. There's a really successful retirement program called Save More Tomorrow that's based on some principles from what we call behavioral economics, but purely for marketing reasons, we don't call it economic psychology. Anyway, that's how people save more money, and that's all cool, but I don't think there's anything quite like this. The last test, I think, is easier, but one that we still don't pass, and it is one way to check for progress in a field is to see like what amount of our history is still active and fertile, and what amount of our history is just history that now you can read for context, but we don't actually use that stuff. Like, for instance, if I go to the doctor and I'm like, "Doc, I'm coughing and sneezing. Which one of my humors is out of whack?" They wouldn't even tell me I'm necessarily wrong. The question wouldn't make sense to them. And this isn't a guarantee that we've made progress, but it is at least suggestive. And I don't think we have this in psychology. All of our history is still quite relevant.
So just so I understand, it's not you're saying that there couldn't be a combustion engine in the psychological domain. It's just that academic psychologists have contributed it. So I'll give you a version of a combustion engine, and that's the method of loci, memory palaces.
Yeah.
Demonstrably incredibly useful technology.
Yep.
People don't know exactly why it works.
Yep.
But many people use it. I know it wasn't invented by psychologists.
Yeah.
So is that your main point? It's just that somehow this scholarly background doesn't contribute to making new technologies.
Yes, that's right. And what I would love to see is not just a method of loci, but what is the box that does the method of loci for you? So the thing about that method is you need to know the method to use the method, which it's still helpful. But I think there's another level of development beyond that where we understand it well enough that you don't have to know the knowledge to use the knowledge. Yeah.
I'm thinking about your reference to marketing, right? Marketers are pretty good at selling product. There's a pretty tight loop between marketing departments and advertising campaigns. One area that might be working is addiction by design, right? So the creation of online games that people can't stop playing, gambling, apps, things like that. Would that be a counter?
Yeah.
People are pretty good at translating psychological insights into money-making products?
It's funny, I got this same question the other day when I was giving this talk, or a version of this talk, to a room full of psychologists. A guy came up afterward and he was like, what do you mean we can't turn this into technology? Look at Facebook, look at Instagram. Like, those are all created by psychologists. And my challenge to him was like, well, but what knowledge that we created are they using? I understand that their PhD says social psychology on it, or psychology or whatever, and then they go to these places and they build these tools, but it's not clear like which thing we made that they're then taking and using to make those things, other than doing similar things to what the marketers are doing, which is A/B testing. Like, I have an intuition, I can very quickly see what comes out of it. His response to that question was like, well, we don't know because they won't tell us. Which I think is both a little bit conspiratorial, but also we train these students. Like, we know what they know. And so unless they go into these places and they generate a bunch of knowledge using the methods of psychology that we then never learn about, it seems to me like unlikely that whatever makes them powerful is what they gained from the academic study of the mind.
One example is in video games, people who design video games have a pretty good understanding of how people misunderstand probabilities. And so 20 years ago, they were already manipulating the outcomes of random number generators to make people understand it. They stumbled upon that sort of well in advance
of
any of the heuristics and biases that are true that
was created. Yeah. Yeah, I wish we'd been there first. Right, this final test. Again, this isn't a guarantee that we've made progress, that there's some part of our history that's now just there for curiosity and not for active hypothesis generation. But this isn't something that's true for us. Like, we think of, there are parts of psychology that would like to think of Freud as being our prehistory, but Freud is very much still in the room with us in that 29% of practicing psychotherapists are trained in the psychodynamic tradition, which is to say a neo-Freudian tradition where talking about things like the id and the ego and the superego are still very much within the Overton window. In fact, you can go to many of our finest institutions and be trained in psychoanalysis, where if you read the stuff that they say to recruit people to these programs, they are very clear, we are doing what Freud did. An anecdote from my own career, like, my senior thesis was about the original finding from social psychology, which is social facilitation, which is just where people do simple tasks faster in the presence of other people. You can also find this in roaches. I didn't use roaches, but it's cool with roaches that, like, roaches will run through a tube faster when you give them an audience of roaches to watch them, which is a cool effect. But, and we've done a bunch more studies on this, but now the effect is, like, pretty much still the way it was in, like, 1898 when they found this with rolling spools of fishing reel or whatever. And, like, my senior thesis was very much just, like, plucking out that idea that's 130 years old or whatever and continuing to use it. Similarly, we had this whole, like, cognitive revolution thing that was, we destroyed the behaviorists, but the concepts, to your point, of the behaviors are still very much with us. Reinforcement, conditioning, stimulus response, all of that, like, that's still with us. It hasn't been subsumed. When you read it in the textbook, it's not just history. It is also a concept that's still active. So I think overall, from my vantage point as a person trying to get us closer to our goal, I don't think we are getting a lot of bang for our buck. And I would really like to know why. But before I do, I'll answer your question.
Well, it's interesting because, in physics, I don't think our old questions are silly yet. And, 400-year-old physics is still around as an important, as an important set of ideas. At some level, it's been superseded, but not in a way that discards it. So, I'm fine with the idea that Freud kind of had a good point about the subconscious and that Skinner kind of had a good point about behavior and reinforcement, but that none of these alone are, these all need to be combined with other ideas. So, the stuff you just showed is only 100 years old, right? So, I would worry that if you discarded it, it would mean that you were just faddish and that you, by definition, paid attention to the latest stuff, which then 10 years later you realized was nonsense, and then you were paying attention to the new latest stuff.
Yeah, I think there's an important difference between fad and progress. Like, psychology has plenty of fads. There are things that are popular to do now. So it'd be a little bit weird to run a study on social facilitation because it's not what we do, but it wouldn't be out of bounds. No one would think it's nonsensical. And so it's only been around for 100 years. We also have to divide by the denominator of how long our field has been around, which is not much longer than 100 years. So if you think about in the history of, I mean, experimental psychology emerges as an individual scientific discipline in about like the 1860s or 70s. If you think about the history of physics, if you go back far enough, this is true, right? Like what Aristotle meant by motion is not what we mean by motion now. And if you were to ask why the flames are rising, the answer that you would get is not just wrong, it's like nonsensical in a way that the words don't mean the same things. That's the kind of discontinuity that I'm looking for. Okay, now why, if I'm right, in fact, that we are not making progress maybe proportional to the amount of time and effort that we are putting into it, like why might that be? I think there is one reason for this, and it is because we are in a pre-paradigmatic state of our field. I know we have a lot of different backgrounds in the room, so apologies if this is like old hat to most people, but this idea from Thomas Kuhn, the philosopher of science, I think has a lot of legs, which is the history of science unfolds as you have some model of the world, you've got a paradigm, you encounter anomalies that don't make sense with it, that leads to a moment of crisis, which leads to a revolution, which leads to a new paradigm, and the whole cycle begins again. I know that he was like kind of inconsistent as to like whether this represented progress. I am not inconsistent on this. I think this does represent progress. And the reason we aren't making that much progress is because we're not in this cycle. We are here on this on-ramp. We have not discovered a paradigm for psychology. Instead, we mainly work in a series of what I consider proto-paradigms, which are like ways of doing things that are not necessarily like a coherent vision of the world. I can give you a few examples. One that has been very fertile in my neck of the woods in social psychology has been this idea that situations matter. And so pretty much any famous social psychology study you can name, maybe even most of the famous psychology studies that you could think of, are in this tradition of showing that the situation has some kind of effect on the way that people behave. Bystander intervention studies, the Milgram shock experiments, the Stanford prison experiment, which later turned out to basically be an episode of reality TV. But even so, is like, that's what this is. Those elaborate pantomimes are meant to show that it's not just personality that matters. Look, we can put people in situations and it really affects the behavior that they have. The reason why those studies hit so well is because they were falsifying a reasonable hypothesis at the time, which was that only personality matters. That's why I think this was a really productive proto-paradigm for a long time. But it's also why I think it's run out of steam and there's not much left, I think, to discover here. Another one that we've been doing for a long time is this idea that people don't obey the optimal rules of decision making. Like this proto-paradigm was like good enough to win 2 Nobel Prizes in a different field. So I think it's pretty good that like this is a reasonable hypothesis to falsify, and we've falsified it many, many times for many decades. And I don't think there's also that much left to learn here. So this was once productive. I'm not sure that it's going to continue to be productive in the future. And then there's a third one that I think accounts for what a lot of psychology is, even though no one ever really talks about it this way. But it is the pick a noun and study it way of approaching psychology. That like it is well within bounds to pick a word out of the word cloud like leadership and then make that your expertise. So if you're a person who studies leadership, you can make a leadership scale. You can interview CEOs. You can try to predict which students in high school become class president. And this can all be under the heading of I'm studying leadership, even if it's not clear how any of this goes together or accumulates over time. So no one in graduate school will tell you like, hey, youngster, like, why don't you flip through the dictionary and pick one of these things? But this to me is mostly what we do. And I think it is unclear how this makes us, how this gives us progress over time. I also think we should consider like, well, why do we keep doing those things? Even if like some of them don't seem to have given us that much useful stuff in the first place and others seem to be giving us less and less. And I think there's a few challenges that we've had in our history, 2 from our history and 2 from the nature of studying the mind in the first place that that have gotten us here. One is the late emergence of our field. Like we didn't get that much time to screw around before statistics got invented. This is Francis Galton, like the godfather of many of the statistical tools we use now in psychology. he's coming up with like correlation regression, him and his students and his eugenicist friends, only a couple decades after we've started doing something that looks like experimental psychology. Now, statistics seems like a great thing, and it can be a great tool. However, it legitimizes the studying of tiny effects to the point where we're so addicted now to statistics that it is almost impossible to imagine how we could even do a research project in psychology without using them. I think this really constrains and shapes our thinking, and I think other fields had the benefit of screwing around for a while before they were able to run a linear regression. Another problem we had is we didn't get much time in our adolescence before we had to grow up and pretend to be professionals. And so professionalization also can be a useful tool, but it's inherently conservative. Like, professions are ways of organizing people's behavior around a set of norms, whether or not those norms are productive. And so it makes it much harder to start a revolution if first everyone has to undergo indoctrination into the way that things are now. And so we didn't have a lot of time where kind of any person with means could become a psychologist. Now there's one way to become a psychologist, and you get a PhD. These are problems, I think, that are unique to our history and unique to the fact that we emerged late. There are other problems that are unique to the study of the mind. And one of them is the illusion of explanatory depth. This is an image from a study that I like a lot, where they just ask participants, do you know what a bicycle looks like? And everyone's like, yeah, I've seen them around. And they're like, cool, so can you draw one for me, please? And this is what people come up with, these bicycles that are impossible. These would not work if you built them, which is odd because bicycles are a very common item in the world. So why is it that people think they know what one looks like and then they can't reproduce one? And what's going on here is people mistake having a little bit of knowledge or having some knowledge for having a lot of knowledge. This is what we call the illusion of explanatory depth. You can find it for a lot of different things. Like, if you ask people, do you know how to use a toilet? They will first look at you weird and go like, yes, of course. I'll get to this in a second. And then when you ask them like, okay, could you please explain like how a toilet works? Like, why does the bowl always refill to the same level? People have a hard time doing that. So what people do know is how to use a toilet. What they don't know is how a toilet works. Yes?
Is the illusion of explanatory depth like a discovery of psychology?
Yes, yes. Yes, it is also, I think, a falsification of folk psychology, right? But like, we are comparing what people think they know to what they actually know. This is a problem, I think, for doing anything where we're trying to acquire new knowledge. Is first, you have to understand the limits of the knowledge you have right now. I think this is especially difficult when you're working with psychology, because people really feel like they know how their minds work and how other people's minds work. I think this is the reason why psychology emerges so late in scientific history in the first place. Like, why is it that we start running studies on people so much later than we start like dropping balls off the Leaning Tower of Pisa or like putting meat in jars to see if maggots appear? And I think it's because we felt much more satisfied with the amount of understanding that we had for ourselves and for others. And I think of the illusion of explanatory depth not as like a deficit that you pay off once and then you're off and rolling and like discovering new things. It is much more like a deductible that you have to pay over and over again, that you have to alienate yourself from the things that you think you know in order to discover things that you don't already know. And the last thing that I think makes it hard to do what we do is the absence of like fact checkers in nature. I think it is remarkable when you look back at human history, how many different cultures had traditions of astronomy, like how interested people were in looking at the stars and trying to explain what was going on with them. And in fact, I've heard someone make the claim that like, we may never have developed science if we didn't live in a solar system where we could see things moving around and wonder why that was happening. The nice thing about, say, like an eclipse is that if you see it happen and you try to predict it happening again, you know whether you were right or not. Like, it's really hard to p-hack that result or fake the data. Whereas with just a little bit of confirmation bias doing psychology, you can accommodate virtually anything you discover into what you already think that you know. And these four factors, I think, make it such that it's really hard for us to discover anomalies and like build up pressure over time for us to do something different. It's like we are in a pressure cooker with the pressure valve stuck open. And so all the steam just comes out and the pressure never builds up. Yes.
Yeah, although I agree 99%, but on the first one, there's of course also a huge tradition of phenomenological research in psychology. which was not statistical at all. And that was also not particularly successful.
It's true, yes.
And the one I really miss is actually the human mind is just more complex than anything else that we study. So, and we study ourselves. So is it also not just the case that we study something that is it's the most difficult thing to study?
To your first point, it's a great point. I totally agree with you. Like, we were doing other things that didn't seem to go much of anywhere. The problem with statistics is that it gives you feedback that things are working, whether or not they really are, right? It can't tell you, it can only tell you whether you have a certain signal to noise ratio. It can't tell you whether you've discovered something that matters. But it creates a social reality where it's like, look, I've got the statistical result, which suggests that I've discovered something, even if I haven't. To your point about complexity, I mean, far be it from me to conjecture about complexity in this room. However, and look, this is something for which I have no knowledge, but or no evidence, but it certainly seems that things seem very complex before you understand them. And so the same way that we might feel about studying the mind today, I think might have been the way alchemists felt about trying to do their thing, circa 1597, where one day you pour your things in and the reaction works, and the next day it doesn't. And because you don't yet have the schema necessary to understand why it worked and why it didn't, it might seem like, well, it's who can say the universe is too random, there's too many variables, Venus was over here, or I wasn't pure enough of heart, and like that's why it didn't work. And you'll never understand it until you understand like, oh, things are made of elements. And I think it will continue to look that complicated until we discover the structure. Yeah.
And the other one is actually the ethical constraints we have in psychology. So you already said this before, some studies we cannot do.
Yeah.
Psychology studies, it's very hard to find the truth about certain things.
Yeah, it's true. Maybe I should put that on the slide as the fifth one. Because you're right. We also, this is also, I think, somewhat historical that like we developed ethics comparatively early in our field compared to how much other people could, you know, torture dogs or whatever and discover their things. Yes.
I actually like your most recent point. It's maybe it's one reason why the A/B testing on Facebook has discovered much more. Mm-hmm. There's experiments we'd love to do.
Yep.
Right. But it would be morally wrong to do them. Right.
Yeah.
I'm wondering. One thing I'd be interesting to see in your perspective here is there are some things that might just be impossible, right? So you can imagine giving this talk and being like, you know, Newton's been great, but like we have no perpetual motion device and it doesn't look like one's on the horizon and we've been trying and trying, right? So some of the things that you're criticizing psychology, which is great, do it. You're criticizing psychology for may actually be, we just haven't recognized that they're impossible, right? Curing depression, for example, right? May actually be something that is impossible. Therapy may in fact be impossible, right? Therapy is just paid friendship and that's fine. So I'm wondering, do you think there are things that we want psychology to do, but actually it's like asking the physicist to give us infinite energy wells?
Yeah, it is always possible that things are impossible and always difficult to know whether they are or not. And so many things that have seemed to be impossible later turned out to be possible because we didn't have a sufficient understanding. And I don't think we are close to any kind of theoretical ceiling as to why it would make sense for things to be impossible. For instance, the treating of depression, it is extremely unlikely that we have actually figured out what it is that we're talking about when we say depression. That like we have this word that corresponds to these things that cannot be one natural kind. And so there's gotta be some progress left to make when we better understand this thing that right now we understand as a statistical abstraction. Will it ultimately be able to eradicate it? Like, maybe, maybe not. But right now, we're not very good at treating it at all. I think without having much time to develop our tools or much ability to develop our tools. So like the only way to figure out whether something is impossible or not is to keep trying and to try better, which is what I hope that we do. And that's really what I'm on about. Oh, yes.
I want to push back on your no paradigm or pre-paradigm.
Uh-huh.
I think Galton throws this into relief. I think it's that there is a pre-existing paradigm, which is that biology is destiny, and that there's been a concept of biology, which is something's hardwired in you, and therefore that's what happens to you. That's how you behave in certain situations. This is why you have specific group differences, because there's just something about people's brains being different. And that's why the situations matter is something that's in relief to that. It's countering some sort of normal science, that it's not just that there's something hardwired about your brain, but that you behave differently in different situations.
Yeah, I think there's an important difference between a paradigm and like a conjecture that we are wedded to. So like the idea that that biology is destiny, I think feels very similar to the idea that humans obey rational decision-making processes or only personality matters, which is maybe an organizing idea that we have, but it lacks the two components that I'm about to lay out for what a paradigm really is. So basically, I think we've diluted the concept of what a paradigm is to the point where it seems like any hypothesis is a paradigm. And I think that we should put a line in between these because we can do things when we have this distinction. This will make more sense in a second when I show you what I'm about to talk about. Yes.
So you pointed out, I think, correctly that depression doesn't refer to a natural kind. Do you think that's true of almost all the terms in psychology, like memory, personality, you know, reasoning, what have you, belief? That's one of the big problems, is that
yes,
these words don't refer to things.
Yes, absolutely. Yes. And I'm about to show you a way that I think we could make the words mean something. Yeah. But I think it's exactly that. Yeah.
So just, I'm curious, maybe, so far be it, you know, for me, just advocate for LLMs and probably now, as you know, we were just sort of panel together, you know how I feel about these things. However, you could argue that what that community that we don't call professional psychologists have been doing in building these new data-rich theories of language are actually doing,
it's the first serious instrumental theory of mind that we've had, right? In other words, it does real work in the world. Whether it's human or, I don't know if it's human or not. And yet it does have a lot of properties that many of the examples you gave do not have. Who cares if it's psychologists doing it, but it is a theory of mind.
That LLMs are a theory of mind?
LLMs could be a theory of mind, yeah.
I suppose I don't know enough about it to know whether it satisfies these two criteria that I'm about to lay out. So, so you can tell me once I do. Right. If we want to revolutionize the engineer one ourselves, how might we do that? And this is the point that, I was about to make. If you want to turn your discipline into a paradigmatic one, you need two things. You need the two components of a paradigm, which are a theory about the units that make up the world that's being studied, and then rules that govern how those units behave and interact. And I think this is the difference between a paradigm and a theory or a conjecture, is that like it is the little things that are marching around the board and the things that they are allowed to do when they march around the board. This is not the way that we normally think about psychology, but it could be. In fact, there was someone who tried to do this 50 years ago. He was really hot for a second. His book got like several thousand citations, and now it's completely disappeared. It's like got memory hold. It's like a Mandela effect thing, where I tried to bring this up to a room full of social psychologists the other day. None of them had heard of it. It's this book called Behavior, the Control of Perception. Maybe it's familiar to someone in the room, especially if you're familiar with cybernetics. This is basically a guy trying to do a theory of psychology out of cybernetics. And so I don't want to bore the people who know about cybernetics, but I do want to explain to people who aren't familiar with it the kind of stuff that it does. Power's point was, like, look, humans have to maintain homeostasis in a lot of different ways. Like, there's a very thin level of existence where we survive. Anything out of that, we die. The best way that nature or humankind has ever discovered for maintaining homeostasis is a control system, which is just a few modules that work together to keep a target variable at a target level. And here's what that looks like in schematic form. You've got your external environment and your internal environment. You got some kind of stimulus that comes across, picked up by a sensor, which turns it into a perception, just a form of information that the system can use, which is then compared to a target level of that perception. The comparator outputs an error signal, which then goes to some kind of effector module that tries to work on the world in some way to reduce that error signal. We are all surrounded by control systems right now, most obviously the thermostat that I think is at the back of the room, which all it's doing is reading the temperature in the room, comparing it to a target temperature. If it's too low, turn on the heat. If it's too high, turn on the air conditioning. Humans also have a thermostat. We have to, because if we get too hot, we die. If we get too cold, we die. And the cool thing is we understand somewhat of how that system works. we know that we have the ability to sense heat in part thanks to the TRPV1 ion channels on our skin, that those are able to generate a perception of temperature. This is a simplified model, by the way. There could be many different control systems, but this is one that we know a little bit about, which is then compared to what has to exist, some kind of internal representation of our desired temperature. And this system can output error signals like it's too hot. And then we have a motor system that can do things like turn on the AC. And this is a way that we cannot die that I think makes a lot of sense. And in fact, I think it's pretty intuitive when you see this, how it would make sense that we would have control systems like this for things that we might consider low level, like temperature regulation or respiration or hunger. But it could also make sense for things that psychologists consider higher level, like sociality. So we know that humans have to maintain contact and relationships with other humans. If not, historically, it was pretty bad for survival. So there could be some kind of control system that governs our sociality. In fact, I think this is probably many systems, but a system like that could look something like we pay attention to like eye contact or time spent in conversation or attention from others or number of friends, which is picked up by some kind of social faculties that maybe we don't fully understand, turned into a perception of our sociality compared to our desired level of sociality. This error system could throw off, or this control system could throw off signals like, I feel lonely, which then the motor system does things like text friends or go to bar or call mom. Now, I'm not saying that like this is definitely the way forward for psychology or like the only way forward, but it thinking in this way, for me anyway, has been really helpful for concretizing a lot of the things that we talk about right now as abstractions. For instance, we talk about loneliness right now. There are people who study loneliness, but what is loneliness to us? It is your responses to a loneliness scale. In this paradigm, in this version of the world, loneliness is something specific. It's an error signal. It's the difference between your desired level of sociality and your actual level of sociality. And speaking of that desired level of sociality, that's something we talk about too right now as extroversion. But right now, extroversion is your responses to an extroversion scale. There's nothing particular about it. In this version of the world, extroversion is something specific. It's a set point. It's a set point on your control system. In fact, one thing that this paradigm gets for free is a theory of personality, that my personality is all of the set points on all of my different control systems. The difference between our personalities are the differences between those set points. So to say that I am more extroverted than someone else is to say that I have a higher set point on like my sociality control system, whatever that may be. The other thing that I like about this paradigm, and by the way, this is sort of like an updated, this isn't exactly what Powers laid out. This is kind of like a neo-Powers. The other thing I like about it is it opens up questions that we might not have asked otherwise. Like for any control system, you can ask, what is it controlling? What are the things that humans are actually paying attention to? And how does its effector system like choose actions that it thinks will reduce the error? Anyway, there's a lot more to say about this, but the important thing that I think about thinking this way is maybe not even ultimately using this as a tool, although I am trying to with some friends of mine. It is a different way of thinking about the way we do scientific inquiry. Like this paradigm is very focused on the units that make up the rules, or make up the universe, and the rules that govern those units, about the mechanisms of mind, which is why I think of it as like a mechanistic way of doing science, which is in contrast to what we usually do in psychology, which looks like this. This is, if you are outside of the discipline, this is like a mediation model where we've done something like measure math ability by probably giving a math test. We've measured something we call math self-efficacy, probably by asking a question like, how confident do you feel when doing math? And we've measured something like interest in the math major by asking you, how interested are you in the math major? And then we produce statistical relationships between these things. These are all abstractions. They correspond to nothing. We made them up as a way of trying to describe the world. I think of this as doing impressionistic science. And the problem with impressionistic science is not that it can't ever do anything for you. This is, I think, the way that we have falsified a lot of folk psychology. The problem with it is that there is an infinite space of possible abstractions you could come up with, of ways that you could measure them, and of statistical relationships you could investigate with other of those abstractions. And it is not clear how any of that ultimately ends up getting you somewhere. This looks like a mediation model. I think it is, in fact, a perpetual motion machine, speaking of perpetual motion. All right, we're almost at the end. So to summarize, I think we've done a great job overturning our folk psychology. I don't think it's clear. We've made a lot of progress in other ways. And so if we want to make progress, we can do two useful things. We can continue falsifying folk psychology. I think that's still a cool thing to do. Or we could work toward a paradigmatic psychology. And if we do that, if we are able to transition from an impressionistic science to a mechanistic science, I think we will draw closer to that promised land of Cincinnati, where our reward shall be great. This is Cincinnati chili. They really do eat it there, and it's delicious. If you're interested in this paper or like any of my work, you can get it at that QR code that goes to my blog, which is where I do all my stuff now. Thank you so much.